Good evening. My name is Krisztina Bombera, and I'd like to welcome you all on behalf of the Hungarian Helsinki Committee to our virtual roundtable discussion with our renowned panelists honoring us with their presence on December 10th, Human Rights Day. So let us start now. Let me introduce our panelists in an ABC order. I'm really happy to have with us Professor András Bozóki, Professor of Political Science at the Central European University, Minister of Culture of Hungary in 2005-2006. And let me just highlight one more period from his professional life. András had participated at the National Roundtable negotiations in 1989 that enabled the creation of a multi-party constitutional democracy in Hungary. András is one of the editors of an 8-volume publication titled The Roundtable Talks of 1989, which argues that these talks were not merely a sideshow, but in fact constituted the hub of the revolutionary transformation. With a big leap to the present, let me quote Professor Bozóki very shortly on the present from an interview he gave this spring. Hungary ceased being a democracy or a rule of law state roughly in 2015-2016. We'll take it from there later. I'm extremely honored to have with us Mr. Thomas Melia, who currently serves as the Washington Director of Pan America. Over his 25-year career, Mr. Melia has been a key actor in the development of policies to strengthen democratic governments around the world. In various positions, he oversaw a wide range of advocacy efforts and programs to assist human rights defenders and civic activists, either as an NGO leader, or as a writer, or a university professor, or as an activist. And he also served in government in the Obama administration. He was USAID's Assistant Administrator for Europe and Eurasia in 2015-2017, and also served as Deputy Assistant Secretary of State. He has coined several catchy phrases too in connection with the current challenges to democracy, such as global political recession or democracy bureaucracy. And he has been underlining the importance of the unreliability of the Orbán governments in security terms, Hungary being, as he says, the weakest link in NATO, in his opinion. He has a Twitter buddy, Mr. Tomáš Deutsch, who is, as of today, is still a Fidesz member of the European Parliament, if I know it correctly. Mr. Deutsch once seemed not to remember who Mr. Melia was. I do not quote Mr. Deutsch, if you allow me. Although they have known each other for decades, Mr. Melia used to be in Hungary for long periods of time after the collapse of communism, when Fidesz needed and enjoyed the support of Mr. Soros or the United States for its efforts to strengthen human rights and democracy in Hungary. And last but not least, in the ABC order, I'm extremely happy to have with us Professor Kim Lane Scheppele, Professor of Constitutional Law at Princeton University, and also an outstanding expert on Hungarian constitutional law. Professor Scheppele has been an honorary Hungarian for a really long time. She moved here full-time in 1994 and worked at the Hungarian Constitutional Court for 4 years, while also co-founding and then chairing the Gender Department at Central European University. Her focus of attention back to Hungary sharpened after the legal procedures of the Fidesz government started to look strange to her, starting in 2010. Her in-depth publications on the Hungarian legal and constitutional developments reached outstandingly large audiences worldwide after Paul Krugman, Nobel laureate economist, published her writings on his blog. Needless to say, Professor Scheppele, just like Mr. Melia, has not succeeded in winning the friendship of the present Hungarian government. She has coined the term Hungarian Frankenstein, which refers to her assumption that this form of government that we have in Hungary now has been created by kind of stitching together perfectly normal rules from the laws of various EU members into a monstrous new whole. I should finish putting the guests' background in context and give the floor over to them for a short expose on whatever you feel important to highlight about our general topic in the next 5-6 minutes, which is, what did we do exactly? And how did we take the steps of transformation from the time of transition and what factors may account for the path that Hungary has taken. Let me stick with the ABC order. So Professor Bozóki, the floor is yours. András, we can't hear you. Thanks for muting yourself while I was speaking.
Thank you very much for the invitation. It is a pleasure to be with you here this evening. As we agreed, I'd like to start with a short analysis of the transformation. As you all know, after all communist satellite countries and regimes collapsed in around 1989-91. So it seems like there was no difference between these countries. Either way, whether it was peaceful or violent, the old regime collapsed. So this gives the impression that internal processes did not play a fundamental role in the change. But I think it's not exactly true. That is true that Poland was the pioneer country in East Central Europe since the birth of solidarity, which started the transformation. It could have happened already 10 years before, but there was no Mikhail Gorbachev in power. So I should indicate that the external conditions, the international conditions, were the defining, extremely important for these countries. But the internal conditions were different, and Poland was the most prepared for the change, and Hungary came as second. So if you remember, there were people like Erich Honecker in East Germany, or Nicolae Ceausescu in Romania. Nobody could expect that those regimes would collapse. The unique character of the Hungarian transition was that it was not driven by the masses. It was unlike in Solidarity in Poland, which was a huge gathering. I mean, at the top times, they had 10 million members, later on a bit decreasing, but still considerable amount of people supported the Solidarity and the opposition. In Hungary, the society was rather passive. People were isolated and politics was not their playground. That was the heritage of the 1956 revolution, when Kádár was calculating that people will be sort of happy and not protesting if they have security and something to eat. They will not be protesting for freedom. So what is characteristic in Hungary? That there was a negotiated, non-violent, elite-driven transition in which intellectuals, people of the dissidents, people of the democratic opposition, they initiated a peaceful human rights driven change. So human rights was a very important value. It was not just one among the other ones. It was which really found everywhere. If we talk about civil society, or civil disobedience, or anti-politics, or the humanization of power. All of these things were in the vocabulary of the Hungarian dissident intellectuals, but in every dimension, it was penetrated with the idea of human rights, which goes back to the 70s. I have no time to elaborate. So these were the principles, these were the values to start, and that indicated that nobody, neither in the opposition nor in the Communist Party, wanted to replay the revolution. People wanted no blood on the streets, wanted to see no blood on the streets. They wanted a sort of negotiated elite settlement. So if we think about, and I am going to close soon, if we think about the major principles, not of the dissidents movement, but of 1989, the national roundtable negotiations, what people shared. I should mention again nonviolence. Nonviolence had such a huge reputation in 89 in Hungary as freedom itself. Of course, freedom was the first, and then second immediately after nonviolence. And the third was was a representative democracy, a constitutional order. A representative democracy indicated that they did not want to experiment with something new. It was not about direct democracy, participatory democracy, although some parties were going that way, but rather to take the Western model. I don't think that this was just pure imitation of the West, so I disagree with those who claim that, but I think representative democracy was important. And the other was also important, which is called broad consensus, that the participants of the roundtable talks believe that democracy is not so much about conflicts and struggles, but let's try to find a deliberative solution, a consensual outcome of the discussion. So I think it was a little bit illusion because they did not consider that the democracy is about debates and conflicts and struggles. They somehow felt that there can be an easy landing, a soft landing from communism to democracy. And finally, the last point I wish to make is that there was a conviction in the political elite in Hungary that Hungary was just prevented by the Russians, by the Soviet Union, to join Europe, because Hungary belongs to Europe, should belong to the European Community. That time it was the name of the European Union. And so obviously when the Soviet troops leave the country, we are already so democratic and liberal and tolerant and ready to join the European Union that there cannot be any problem. So people were very impatient, waiting for the European Union to get an invitation, which lasted for 15 years between 89 and 2004, because people believed that there cannot be any problem. There was a transition, smooth, successful, then a multi-party system, transformation and consolidation, and then finally Europeanization and joining the European Union. So it was like a fairy tale. Nobody really believed that it can be reversed or can be otherwise. So it was a pretty optimistic decade, despite the lot of social problems which came out over the 1990s. Thank you.
You're muted.
Thank you. We're going to make this mistake a couple of other times. I definitely will, and I'd like to apologize in advance. Let me say this in Hungarian. Azok, akik a magyar fordítást keresik, alul a zoom funkcióban az interpretation-t, a földgömböt, ha megnyomják, akkor a Chinese, a kínai nyelvre kattintsanak. És ha valamiért zavaró lenne a két nyelv együtt, ha hallatszik alatta az angol eredeti, akkor a mute original, azt hiszem, hogy azt adja ki, mute original audio, és azoknak, akik angolul szeretnék követni, azok pedig maradjanak az off-on, az eredetin úgy, ahogyan most vannak. So, after explaining again how to get the Hungarian translation, I'd like to hand over the floor to Mr. Melia.
Well, thank you, Krisztina, and thank you to the Hungarian Helsinki Committee for convening this discussion today on International Human Rights Day. I think it's an appropriate time to revisit where Hungary has come over these last 30 years. As was indicated earlier, I first arrived in Hungary half a lifetime ago, in 1989, and felt the excitement that was underway. András was talking about the elite-driven transition negotiations. But I saw that in the streets and in the countryside as well, that people were very excited about the chance to rejoin Europe finally after so many years under Soviet repression, communist control. And as I was there for the National Democratic Institute, which was the business of sharing information about political parties and election processes, I was able to get to know key people in many of the new parties and the revived political parties that were playing a more visible public role before, during, and after the roundtable negotiations. So we provided experts from Western European and North American political parties to share information about the building blocks of democratic politics with the Hungarian political parties. And we worked across the board. And in that period, András was talking about the peaceful nature of the transition process. It's important to recall that the Socialist Workers' Party quickly embraced the transition as well, transformed itself into a increasingly European-style socialist or social democratic party, and cooperated very actively in the transition and in the development of the first elections. We did not work with the Socialist Party before the 1990 elections, but once the parliament was formed after 1990, we engaged with all of the six parties that were then playing roles in the parliament. And I think it's important to remember that because of the balance of forces and the way people grew unhappy with the government of the day, for a decade, more than a decade, the Hungarian voters always voted out the incumbent government. They did that in 1990, 94, 98, in 2002. There began to be established a routine of transfer of power. Parties would be in government, then they would be in opposition, they might come back in a different coalition. And Hungary was one of the early, most visible signs of a successful transition in Central and Eastern Europe in that period of the 1990s. And that's why we, at the NGO community, the international NGOs that were sharing information, mostly moved on to other regions of the world by the middle of the 90s. And it's as Hungary grew closer to European Union membership, official agencies did as well. Although in 1990, the US government did massive reorganization in addressing Central and Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union. We went from a posture of confrontation and preparation for war. Almost immediately and overnight, we transformed the American government into an agency for cooperation with the democratizing countries and the newly emerging independent states in the Soviet Union. And it's really quite remarkable to think about the speed with which the US and Western allies changed our approach to former communist countries, because governments and peoples alike said they wanted to become more democratic, more integrated into the Western world. So for most of these last 30 years, that has remained the US posture, certainly with regard to Hungary. We want Hungary to succeed as a country, as an economy, as a security partner, and we've provided a vast array of assistance to Hungarian decision makers and agencies to modernize and democratize. So it has come as a major disappointment in the last 10 years to see how the constitution was rewritten so speedily and so dramatically, and how a variety of building blocks, I think Professor Scheppele will elaborate, apparently democratic constitutional mechanisms have been cobbled together in a way that makes it an undemocratic system. And the increasing marginalization of opposition voices, whether they are in the NGO community, in political parties, or media outlets, has caused a lot of alarm, as has the various institutional mechanisms to consolidate an enduring control of parliament and government and society. It's interesting that this week, Hungary and Poland led the transitions 30 years ago, keen to join the European Union, NATO, run the European Union experiment into the ground. I think we're at a critical moment right now, this week, with the posture that Hungary and Poland have taken with respect to Brussels, quite literally biting the hand that feeds them, wanting to take all kinds of financial assistance. And we can leave aside how that is distributed within the country. That's a whole nother discussion. But for two of the newest, most dependent countries, the European Union to have laying down on the railroad tracks to stop a massive assistance program is really quite remarkable. And it may spell a significant change in the way the European Union is organized and the way it operates. I think it's going to be next to impossible to get the wealthier countries in Europe to continue to subsidize increasingly obstructionist, non-democratic government in Hungary and in its neighbor Poland. So looking back over these 30 years, there are various pivot points, but one of the key pivot points, I think, was when the 2002 election, when Fidesz lost and went into opposition. There's an interesting article this week in the Independent, the British newspaper, by Zsuzsa Szélényi, who is one of the founders of Fidesz and one of the first members of parliament, in which she points out that Viktor Orban never accepted the results of that election and mobilized his supporters and his followers to resist acknowledging the legitimacy of the government that came back in after that. And sad to say, we're seeing echoes of that now in my country, the United States, with Donald Trump rejecting the election results that he's lost by 8 million votes. He's continuing to delegitimize the successor government and our election process itself. So one of the things that we in the United States have learned is that all of the democratic countries are somewhere on a spectrum of consolidation of institutions and procedures and norms. And norms are the habits that people live by within around the rules of procedure. So I think, and many people like me who have been involved in international democracy support and sharing of experience have turned our attention to the United States in the last few years. I now work for an organization, PEN America, which is the writers organization in the United States, part of a global network of PEN centers. We spent a lot of time in the last couple of years working on civic education in the United States, media literacy, trying to identify and expose what disinformation and misinformation looks like in public discourse, because we're awash in it now in the United States. And whereas the Russians may have contributed notably to the confusion around our 2016 election, this past year, mainly American disruptors trying to flood the information ecosystem with false and inaccurate information on everything from whether the COVID pandemic is real to whether our votes can be counted accurately. And so I think those of us who are committed to liberal democratic processes, and that's a better way for people to organize society and to live, we have a lot more work to do than we thought back in 1990 we'd ever be able to do. And I think with this global democratic recession that's been so well documented by Freedom House over the last 15 years, Hungary has been the most conspicuous backslider, going from a free country to a partly free country. I think we all have a lot of work to do. So it's good to be back in Hungary, so to speak. I look forward to the rest of the conversation.
Thank you very much. And I'd like to listen to what Professor Scheppele has to say.
Yeah, well, thank you so much. And it's so good to see so many friends, even if you're only black boxes with names on them. But it's lovely to be back in Hungary, at least figuratively speaking, and also to have this kind of long view of what's been happening to the country over the last several decades. My first trip to Hungary was actually only in 1992. And I'd been invited to teach a human rights course. And since today's, you know, Human Rights Day, it's interesting to think about what happens to human rights. So my first time in Hungary, I was supposed to be teaching with two young human rights focused law professors. And my co-teachers for that course have gone on to other things. So one was someone called József Szájer, and the other was Krisztina Morvai. And they were my co-teachers the first time I came to Hungary. And I must say, I wouldn't have guessed where they wound up. And that's in some ways a kind of story about the country as a whole. You know, so first in those kind of early days of transition, you know, what was so clear, I think, even, you know, in that moment was that, how to put it, people actually began to take democracy for granted very quickly, which is to say that it wasn't a big struggle against people who were holding out. As Tom Melia said, you know, the Hungarian Socialist Workers Party immediately became a party contesting elections in a multi-party system. In fact, there had already been some reforms going back to 1988, you know, already, you know, laws passing the parliament for, you know, sort of liberalizing the possibility of civil liberties. And of course, the constitution itself. I mean, Hungary was the first of the, you know, Soviet satellite states, as we used to call them, that got its own new constitution, October 23rd, you know, 1989. And that constitution was the result of this roundtable process that originally started off trying to reform the constitution only to open up the space for a multi-party election. And what it wound up doing was basically rewriting the entire constitution as a constitutional amendment. So there were a couple of important things, I think, about that new constitution. First was that that new constitution in 1989 was written behind, you know, what John Rawls has famously called a veil of ignorance. You know, literally at the time that the roundtable was going on, the Hungarian Socialist Workers Party actually thought it could win an election. But so did the opposition. But nobody was really sure, right? So if you're writing a constitution under those conditions, you put in place a variety of mechanisms that make the world tolerable if you lose, because nobody was certain of winning. And that's actually a really wonderful moment to draft a constitution. And I think that that's one of the reasons why, even though the Hungarian constitution was patchwork, it was piecemeal, it didn't include everything it probably should have, it wasn't elegant, it wasn't pretty to look at, and it still had the official title, right, of the 20th law of 1949, it was nonetheless a lot better than some of the constitutions that were written after there had been an election or two and everybody could see who the winners and losers were. So I think that Hungary inadvertently in some way started off with this advantage of having a new constitution largely emerge from the roundtable. I might say that, you know, one thing, since again, it's Human Rights Day, the rights provisions in the Hungarian constitution, that in 1989 version, were so interesting. So some of the people who worked on this told me that, you know, there was no agreement at the roundtable to have a new constitution. So how did we get one, right? We Hungarians, I love being an honorary Hungarian. So how did this new constitution come about? Well, it came about because they had to change the existing constitution enough to permit multi-party elections. So they start crossing things out, you know, and by the time they cross out enough, there's nothing much left, right? So the question is, how do you fill in? What do you replace things with? And one of the ideas was to say, well, let's take things that are already laws in Hungary and put them just into the constitution. And two of those things were the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, which Hungary had been a signatory to. And so the drafters of the constitution, which by the way included not only members of the democratic opposition, but also people from, you know, the party and the government, and particularly from the justice ministry, they cut and pasted the international human rights agreements into the Hungarian constitution. That's why if you look at that draft from 89, you know, it goes up to Article 70, and then it's Article 70A, 70B, 70C, because they were just adding lots of rights for which there were no new numbers, you know. But this was the idea, was that this new constitution was going to link Hungary with the global human rights movement. And I think that was an important statement in that new constitution. By the time I got to Hungary in 92, I actually moved, as Krista said, in 1994. I came to study the Hungarian Constitutional Court because it was the most powerful court in the country, in the world, actually, I think at that time. And because its decisions, and they remain decisions that I've taught them to classes all over the world. Constitutional law was one of Hungary's great exports to the world, I think, in the 1990s. And a lot of what the Constitutional Court did was to give meanings to rights. That was really the court's, you know, great love, was elaborating the rights jurisprudence. And the court was incredibly popular for doing so. You know, public opinion polls during that time showed that the court routinely had 80% public approval. Actually, after it knocked down the Bokarstromog, after the austerity program was cut back in 1995, I guess that was, the popularity of the court soared above 90%, right? So the court was in many ways in tune with what the public wanted. And so this is where I want to fast forward a little bit. So what happened? Like, how can Hungary be in the state it's in now? And part of it is, I think, that the court sort of had everyone's back, as we say, right? The court was there to defend the democratic institutions, to defend human rights. Thousands of people every year would go to the court to vindicate their rights. And the system actually worked fairly well. It worked fairly well, sort of well enough to fade into the background in a way, you know, well enough to be taken for granted. So the question is, what happens if you get someone who is determined to undermine the system? And this is where one of the weaknesses of the 1989 Constitution really shows itself. Basically, that 1989 Constitution didn't think a lot about redundant checks and balances. The primary check that was introduced into this new system was a constitutional court. And so somebody, a lawyer perhaps, a lawyer with political ambitions perhaps, could look at the system and realize that if you could capture the Constitutional Court, you could remove a lot of the constraints that it would exist on a unicameral parliament that had this easy amendment rule, and that constitutional amendment rule, a single two-thirds vote of the parliament can overturn, you know, can change the Constitution, any part of the Constitution. That was a rule from the 1949 Soviet Constitution that was never changed in 89. So that rule basically has led now to Hungary's destruction. Hungary's destruction. You've got a political party run by lawyers, Fidesz. The inner circle met in law school. Most of the inner circle were people who had thought like lawyers. And unfortunately, lawyers can be very clever about things. And there was a kind of Achilles heel, a fatal weakness in the Hungarian constitutional system, which had to do with the fact that there was this easy amendment rule combined with an election law drafted before the first election that was never really fundamentally changed, and that was worried about having too many parties, too much fragmentation. And the election law, therefore, put a thumb on the scale in favor of the plurality that won the election. It was always a disproportionate election law, worried about fragmentation. By the time of the 2010 election, however, there were two big parties, two small parties. Fragmentation was not the issue. And so in 2010, the magic happened that was sort of, in some sense, you know, bad magic happened that was built structurally into the system. A single party was able to, winning only, you know, 53% of the vote, to get a constitutional majority in the parliament to change everything. And it's that structural weakness that has led us to where we are today. It was built into the system at the beginning, though people didn't see it. And once you have the power to change the constitution from morning to night, you are no longer constrained by law. And this is when Hungary's lawless period began. But I always say, you know, Hungarian democracy did not die a natural death. It was murdered. And it was murdered by constitutional lawyers who saw the weakness in the system and took advantage of it. And here we are. Thanks.
Before we move on, let me turn to András with how you just finished, Kim. It was murdered. Hunger didn't die of natural causes. Still staying with the transition and the foundations. András, there is this almost commonplace argument about how much the transition elites can be blamed for laying too loose, too weak foundations. And how much should they be left alone because the problems arise later and for different reasons? What do you think of it?
I think there were two major mistakes made in 1989 at the round table. One is the first is the one which was just elaborated by Kim, that two the disproportionate nature of the electoral law, which made very easy for certain parties to reach two-third majority. And the other is the other laws which required two-third majority as well, which wanted the active participation of the opposition in the governance, which is ridiculous. You know, you cannot expect from the opposition to participate in the governance that deprives from the responsibility of the government if 51% is not enough to govern. So there was a securitization of democracy. I think it was a problem that the regime changing or transition elite overestimated the goodwill of people who are occupying the institutions. They were focusing therefore only on institutions and not the worst case scenarios. They believed that these institutions will work. Actually, two-third majority was reached by MSP and SDS, the socialists and the liberals in 94, and still they did not misuse the regime. So democracy was upheld. Obviously, if certain political forces want to destruct consciously the system, as Viktor Orban finally did, it is a murder, yes. Mm-hmm. But let me just say one, 2 points to this. As I said, there was an optimism and goodwill towards the institutions, but socially speaking, the 1990s was a problem for the society. Hundreds of thousands of people lost their jobs. The regime was unable to offer them alternatives, and unemployed people were offered to go to early retirement. So suddenly the workforce of the country was reduced, and there was a bigger burden on the regime that they have to keep up. So it was like a neoliberalism combined with a sort of welfare state, which was too heavy for this new nascent democracy. That is one thing, that is a structural problem, this inexperience of the transition elites in economic matters. And that made the transition and democracy unpopular within 10 years. And the other thing is that the missing left, the Hungarian Socialist Workers Party is supposed to be a left-wing party, but they were driven also by bureaucrats and party apparatchiks, and they were very happy with the reforms. They believed in modernization, and they forgot solidarity, the other value of the left, traditional value of the left. So this, during the process of privatization, many of these people became extremely rich, and people found that they don't have a political place to go. There is no left-wing party which will defend them from this early period of wild capitalism in Eastern Europe. So then they turned to the Free Democrats. And the Free Democrats, together with the socialists, they initiated the Bokros package, which was good for the macroeconomic point of view, but it was socially a huge problem again. And then people, voters, were waiting for a genuine left, but they didn't get. So, and also liberals were losing this enthusiasm. They were enthusiastic about institution, the constitutional court. They did a beautiful job, but this did not solve the problem of the ordinary people. And they were just waiting to get the benefits of a liberal democracy, but they did not get it, at least the elderly, the countryside people, and so on. And after 10, 12 years, they moved to the populist right. So actually those left-wing constituencies started to support Viktor Orbán, Fidesz, and then later on a little bit Jobbik as well. So I think there was a vacuum. The political party system was imbalanced. And when the country arrived to the global financial crisis in 2008, the left liberal elite was already exhausted. They were running out of ideas. And the populist, nationalist, ethno-nationalist right wing became more and more enthusiastic. So I think the first decade belonged to the liberals, but the second decade belonged already to the populists, which turned out to be this landslide of Fidesz in 2010. And what happened after 2010 is another story. Probably we will be discussing that.
Thank you. Yeah. We're going to move beyond 2010 a little later. I think the way you put it at the beginning, András, was that there was an overestimation of good faith and goodwill by the transition elites. And that's pretty much true to the European Union as well with the member states. But before we get to the EU, let's take a look at another force as well, another global force. I'd like to turn to Mr. Melia, asking him from the transition time, maybe up to today, as you will, about how prepared US foreign policy was at the time of the Central Eastern European events. Was it in a supportive or an active, or rather in a passive reactive position? In either case, what marked, what shifts, what major events marked the position that were taken from period to period? And in general, what is the scale for action or interference for US foreign policy to restrain declines and backslides, especially in countries that are members of respected and trusted international organizations? We're talking of a NATO and an EU member country.
Well, the United States, for all its capabilities and global reach, was not at all prepared for the collapse of communism in the Soviet Union and Central Europe and the Balkans. We were completely unprepared for that. Just as we were completely unprepared for 9/11 and other major intrusions on our sovereignty and our country.
Wasn't the Pearl too far-fetched? I mean, you couldn't be that unprepared to the collapse of communism as to 9/11. Did you really mean that?
I meant that we were unprepared for the reach that global terrorists had into the United States. 9/11 was completely unexpected by our political establishment. Maybe a few tactical analysts in the system who knew about certain plans by certain agents, but as a system, we were not prepared for that. Which is why, in both cases, after 1989, there was there was a major reorganization of the US government. And part of that reorganization was what was called at the time the peace dividend, which meant that the United States dramatically reduced our intelligence agencies, our military presence in the world. And the idea in Washington and in the United States was that we don't have to be spending all this money to defend against the potential invasion by the Soviet Union and its allies, then we don't need all this money for our defense establishment. So budgets went way down in the early 90s for the international agencies in the US government. One thing that went up was the investment in US Agency for International Development, and created a whole new bureaucracy in Washington to provide assistance to the former communist countries in the billions first decade. So whereas we had been accustomed to providing certain kinds of humanitarian and institution building assistance in other parts of the world, we had never planned to do that in the communist countries of Europe and Eurasia. But pretty quickly, we pivoted to that. As I say, a whole new bureaucracy was set up, a lot of money was put into it, and Hungary and its neighbors were immediate beneficiaries of that. So that there were not only advisory assistance programs, there were investment monies came in from the private sector and from the government, from the official sector. So that while we were not prepared for the collapse of communism, I think we responded to it in a positive way to try to assist all of these new countries, some of which were beset with violence, especially in in the Balkans and in South Caucasus and parts of Central Asia. But in the main, most of those transitioning countries remain peaceful, dealing with an economic collapse in most every case, Andras referred to, that I think we were also unprepared for. Even as we were going into the 90s and providing this kind of assistance and providing the advice on how to write constitutions and parliaments and court systems and all that, we were not prepared for the immense collapse of the strange economy that was the communist world. And then, and I remember discussions in that period where people would say, this privatization process of taking major assets, whether it's factories or some functioning companies, and privatizing them, we saw pretty soon that they're all going into the hands of those people who are in the communist establishment or nearby. Some people said, well, at least it's dispersing it from the government. It may be in corrupt hands, but it's in private hands. So that's better than where it was, in the hands of the government. That turned out to be a bad judgment. I think strengthening the law enforcement capabilities to address corruption and to appreciate the cleverness of those lawyers, some of those aspiring business people and oligarchs, I think we were slow to react to that in the 90s. And just as after 9/11, we had to do a major reorganization of our government to address a different kind of challenge, which was this metastasizing terrorist threat emanating from failed states like Afghanistan was at the time. That's why Osama bin Laden was based there and was able to reach out from there. I would just say that the Arab Spring that came another decade later in 2011 was also something that we were completely unprepared for. The downfall of many of the autocracies across the Middle East was again unanticipated. It was initially welcomed. And then the complications of economic difficulties, the political battles, efforts by some bad actors in almost every country to try to take advantage of the confusion and the disarray to seize control in an authoritarian way. I think we counted on better angels and more societies to prevail. Even though some in our system and some in our conversations in government and in Congress and in think tanks thought that optimism was not justified. And I think in many cases, it turns out that the optimism was not justified. Mm-hmm. Tunisia right now is the only country in the Arab world that has successfully transitioned to a democratic state, elections and change of government, coalitions. All the others have gone awry, violence, new forms of dictatorship. So I wish we were smarter. I wish we could influence events in the world more directly and more efficiently than it turns out we can do. I think the fundamental enterprise that I was engaged in back in 1989 and 90 when I went to Hungary for the National Democratic Institute, just to show solidarity with people in other countries, to try to share with them information or resources that they can take advantage of in their own way. Advice can be offered, but it doesn't all have to be taken. And so I think that was the right way to go. But I think we, again, maybe like some others, expected that those who achieved power through increasingly democratic elections in that transition decade of the 90s would be responsible and would be custodians of the public interest rather than seeking to consolidate power and resources and money in their own hands. So I think, I hope we're learning how to help transitions better as they arise, because they continue to do all over the world. People are unhappy with repressive government and the lack of opportunity and the denial of individual rights and the abuse of people, like we're seeing nearby in Belarus right now. Like we're seeing in other parts of the world. people will rise up at some point and say, no more, and how we can help them secure a better future economically and politically remains elusive, but I think it remains important to try to figure that out.
Thank you. Let's try to share our time evenly between the past and the present and the future, the coming up elections in 2022 and the newly passed election law. Let's focus first on the EU as well. Professor Scheppele, let me come back to your Frankenstein state term, because it's very helpful in explaining how Hungarian government officials and the country has been amazingly confident and successful in front of EU institutions in international interviews. You ask them about the state of the world and they answer about the health of a single tree in it. The EU has been unable to tackle this problem so far, but and the EU court has done a better job. We've lost all the cases, if I know that correctly. Correct me if I'm not right.
All the big cases.
Do you believe that the new rule of law standards with the great compromise of the week will be more effective to tackle this?
So we're talking today when there's a big conversation happening in Brussels, right? Because I must say that one way to get the world's attention is to veto the budget of the EU. So Hungary and Poland together have been on everybody's mind as a result. And I saw actually here in the chat that that Zsuzsa Szabo also was asking about this. So the EU has had trouble figuring out what to do with Hungary. You may notice the EU has been somewhat more active dealing with Poland, which is also going through a sort of democratic deconstruction. And part of this is because, Viktor Orban knows Europe very well. He's actually been at the table of heads of state longer than anyone in the European Council, including Angela Merkel, if you count Orban's first term. He's been there for 14 years, Merkel's only been there for 12. And before that, Orban was studying the EU from his position in the Hungarian parliament. So he knows completely well how the EU operates, better than many of the people that he's dealing with. And so he's been able to figure out how to disable the mechanisms that the EU might use to try to bring states under control. So the first thing is that he realizes that the EU is very nervous about being seen as a kind of colonial power. So the EU doesn't have trouble going into Poland when Poland is violating its own constitution. And the EU goes in and says, we think you have a rule of law problem because you're violating your own laws, and we're here to help, right? But when you have a government where everything is legal, where the laws can be changed from morning to night, and every time the Hungarian government acts, it's acting consistently with its own laws, the EU has a hard time coming in and saying, follow what law? Our law? They're not going to do that. And so it's put the EU in a position where it just didn't know how to make sense of what was happening and it didn't understand exactly what it could do. So now it's finally coming around to thinking about some tougher mechanisms. So one is that there is a possibility. Article 7 of the Treaty of the European Union allows member states to be essentially deprived of their funds, their vote. They're thrown out, except that the EU doesn't have any way to completely throw out a member, but they're sort of excommunicated, so to speak. Now, the problem with that mechanism is that it requires at some point along the way to the sanction, a unanimous vote of all the other member states. So as soon as Poland joined, this mechanism became unusable. And when they were drafting the treaties, frankly, they thought they'd never use it. They never imagined that there would be more than one state. So that's been disabled. So now, and this is what's being discussed this afternoon, Hungary and Poland have been vetoing both the budget and the so-called recovery fund because it's coming attached to a provision that would allow the Commission and the Council working together to cut funds to a member state that violates the rule of law. And the Hungarian government, of course, has insisted that this is now a political activity. This is something that doesn't belong in the budget. And the other EU states beg to differ. So I just muted myself while I coughed. So what's happening?
It's a win or a loss that maybe after the new elections in 2022.
Yeah, so Orban has won on this one. Mm-hmm. I mean, however they want to spin it. I must say, until yesterday, I didn't see how he was going to get out of it. But the Germans, you know, with all due respect to Angela Merkel's, you know, she has many strengths, but her weakness is that she will always cave into Hungary. Partly this is CDU, EPP, partly this is, you know, whatever. But yeah, so the reason why Orban won is that the regulation, first of all, he got the statement that this rule of law regulation only exists for the term of the new budget. Yeah. So from 21 to 27, the regulation will only be in effect 6 years. And he got the agreement that the regulation won't come into effect until the Court of Justice gets to review it. And only after the Court of Justice reviews it can the Commission develop its guidance about how the regulation will be used.
But it's still a calculation, a hypothesis. Who wins in 2022? We don't know.
Here's the thing. I mean, the recovery fund,
Just really would like to see, because I know that you know in depth the system and you've been part of counseling EU on setting this up. And the point of my question is whether this new set of law, rule of law system, will be able to put countries that are backsliding back on democratic tracks, or it will only be able to stop those that would like to start to follow those in the footsteps of those who've been before them. That's right. A major difference.
Yeah. Well, only the public of a potentially democratic state can make a democratic state. The question is what the outsiders can do. And I think the EU has finally realized that paying for the backsliding state is not helpful, both because the EU is paying for its own internal destruction, but also because the corruption that accompanies backsliding states is partly what keeps them going. So if the EU money can be cut, then, you know, Viktor Orban doesn't have the money to give out to his friends. And then the question is how long he stays in power if he doesn't have all these goodies to give out. I think that's the question. Mm-hmm. And so, but the way this regulation works, though, is that it won't go into effect for 3 years, at least two, maybe 3 years. It will only be in effect for 6 years. So that means there's a little window several years from now after the election. So what happens before the election? Well, the recovery fund is meant to be spent immediately, you know, because it's a recovery fund, because economies are having trouble now. So that money is supposed to be spent during this time before the regulation goes into effect. And then even with the budget, with the general budget, what Orban did in the last budget cycle was he front-loaded, or he spent at the beginning of the cycle, most of the money that was supposed to be stretched out through the entire budget cycle. In other words, Orban's going to spend all the money before the election, and that's going to help him get reelected, right? Because he's going to spend money on things that will make him popular, that will allow him to get reelected and allow him to benefit his friends. So here's the thing about the regulation, and it wasn't like this when it came out of the European Commission, but the Council added this back in. There's a protection for, quote, final beneficiaries. So let's say Orban gives all of this money to his friend, Mr. Mészáros, for example, and he gives all that money before the election. Under the regulation, even if Orban is found to have violated the EU budget rules, they still have to pay Mr. Mészáros, because the final beneficiaries will get all money that has already been committed. So this is why Orban's won. Hmm. There is absolutely no way that the money is really going to be cut.
Let me ask András's reaction to all that has been said so far, and let me connect the question to that so you can have a longer answer that I saw as one of our participants' question as well, something about the change of the regime. As Kim said, a backsliding country can be put back on track by the voters of the country only, and not outside forces. But there have been strong voices in Hungary under saying that a change of this regime is unimaginable by the tool of national elections with the changes to the election law. Others argue that the municipal elections of last year proved just the opposite. if the opposition knows the name of the game and how to play by the game, plays by the rules, it can work. And it seems that the opposition forces have decided on the latter. Poland's example from last year may support it too. There's an opposition majority in the Senate now, for example. What do you think on the role of elections? And what's your reaction to what Mr. Melia and Professor Scheppele have said so far?
Well, thank you. Very hard questions. It's a somehow philosophical question. What is the role of money in politics? Can you get everything, all votes, victories, if you have a lot of money or not? So one interpretation is that actually Orbán was not interested in the structure, but as a good politician, he wanted to gain some time. And if you win time, then you survive. And people think that this vast money that he got will be enough for him to win the elections. And I think that would be normal in semi-democratic or democratic conditions. But it would be good to know the general state of mind of the Hungarian population. I think that they do not respect Orbán anymore. They don't think that he is a charismatic politician who should be respected. So I think this leader democracy approach is not valid anymore. I think people realize that he is stealing the money. And if we have more money, it doesn't mean that it will go to the society.
What makes you say that? What supports what you've just said? Supposedly, the whole combined opposition stands even with Fidesz's support. Kind of even.
Well, I don't think, I mean, maybe I am an idealist. I have American friends who tell me that it is not democracy, it is a plutocracy and only money talks. But maybe as an idealist, I believe that that you cannot exclusively win an election with money, because if the opposition is united, they can beat Fidesz, even in this hybrid regime conditions. It is very hard to survive against the will of the people. I mean, Lukashenko could do this in Belarus, but he is morally already done. He is out. I don't think that he can come back from this. Orbán is, you know, playing. It is on the verge. And of course, the opposition should be united in order to have any chance. And I mean, I agree with those who believe that we cannot expect from Angela Merkel to bring salvation for Hungary. This should be done by the Hungarian voters. It was the Hungarian voters who voted for Orbán, even if the elections were cheated and not clean. Already 2014 was not a clean election. But I think the opposition was fragmented. They were quarreling with each other. They had no good leadership. I think now, if never, the opposition will learn the lesson by 2022. And I think even if the opposition is going to win, Orbán still can move to the presidential chair, replacing Ader. And maybe if the opposition is fragmented, then Fidesz can come back after 1 or 2 years. So it is a very long fight and very difficult, I think. That is my general answer. I think from the viewpoint of Angela Merkel, it is rather a good compromise, because she introduced finally this rule of law mechanism and the sanctions. And for her, Hungary was not the most important country. It was also the southern European countries which wanted to get their money. So all in all, I think she was trying to reach a balance. And now critics can say that the European Union is now deviating from its own European values, whatever it means. It's very hard to refer to European values if it is sold out to Orbán in a bargain position. But maybe Merkel can say that we saved the European values because we introduced the mechanism, but it will be implemented just 2 years from now. So there are a lot of open questions which should be interpreted, but it's, I think, too early to judge. Maybe Kim is right. I hope the situation is less hopeless, I think. Maybe we can believe in better outcome in 2022.
Today is Human Rights Day, and we should focus a bit more on rights, human rights, and courts, and on civil society as well. And a lot of questions by the members of the audience have been referring to civic space that's shrinking and to the European Court of Human Rights and CJEU. Let me start with Mr. Melia, because he has been working in NGOs and in Freedom House for decades. So the question is, regarding, partly to Kim, the use of courts to challenge the backsliding situation. One of the many facts I'm quoting of the situation in Hungary is the shrinking of the civic space available to especially human rights organizations. This has made the use of classic civil activism very difficult. We have therefore seen an increase in so-called legal activism, with more and more cases brought to the European Court of Human Rights and the CJEU. But can this at all challenge the ruling party and its illiberal agenda? How can a court ruling secure human rights and democracy if the government is not willing or interested in implementing the rulings? I'm here thinking of the CJEU ruling on Lex NGO as well. And somebody was asking, maybe Kim can prepare for that, about a possible fast track at CJEU. Mr. Melia?
Well, I'll leave to Professor Scheppele the discussion about implementing court rulings, especially when you have these transnational bodies that, again, depend on the goodwill of governments to abide by interpretations of the rules they have agreed to in a multinational context. Very difficult if you have a government that's willing to ignore its own courts, let alone international bodies like the European Court. As for civil society space, there's a couple dimensions of that. One is the availability of funding from foundations or philanthropy or deep-pocketed individuals to enable different kinds of groups to do research and publicize their findings. And Hungary has moved down the Russian path of kind of criminalizing international donations to groups in Hungary, which is another sign that they're moving down the path towards Russia. Recall the dispute with Norway a few years ago, when the Norwegians were part of their compact with the EU, providing support to civil society in Hungary as they do to other countries. And the Hungarian government took made a huge battle over that. And who gets mad at Norway? Well, Norway is not an actor in the world, but the Hungarian government turned it into a big battle over, Norwegian assistance to civil liberties groups and environmental groups and other kinds of rule of law NGOs. This is kind of, I'm getting to the same point that we were making about elections, is that Hungarians have to want to secure their future at least as much as the international community. Hungarians need to be educated and persuaded to see the importance of some of these actions that are being taken in their name. And
educated how?
Well, that's what the existing, and I know embattled, journalists and civil society groups can be doing. But they need to be doing it beyond downtown Budapest, right? They need to be getting out around the country and doing more, maybe town hall meetings or community gatherings. Reminding people and teaching people about their rights and about the way that this government is violating them. most conspicuously by diverting the money that meant to assist ordinary Hungarians from the EU, diverted to the pockets of the already rich and well connected in Hungary.
Have you seen that working in the various, several, numerous countries that you've been working with all over the globe? If you have a media dominance as much as we do, and all the resources for propaganda and everything going to the government, have you seen grassroots work going beyond Budapest, to stick with my country, work?
Yes, I think next door in Ukraine, you see a very vibrant civil society that has been working against various versions of the establishment and of media dominance by bad actors. Ukraine is much more decentralized in a sense than Hungary is, so that there are many more active town by town groups tracking human rights and other and corruption. I think the big issue in Hungary is really the corruption at the top. An investigative journalist can be very, very helpful in this. You know, the OCCRP is a terrific network of reporters in the region and in Hungary. So I think getting the research, getting the information out, and that's the way to make the case. And I know it's an uphill battle, certainly on the broadcast realm, but online Hungarians have access to a lot of information and more of it that can be produced in Hungarian language. I think will be valuable. And you know, some of the groups, not only Hungarian Helsinki Committee, but others that are represented in this call, are doing good work. It just needs to be the dissemination of that to Hungarian people, I think, has to be prioritized. And maybe sometimes we are all too focused on Brussels or Berlin or Washington rather than trying to mobilize the citizens, per se. So I think the eventual success of Hungary's democracy will depend on civil society and journalists and getting the truth out to people.
Professor Scheppele, classic civic activism versus legal activism and the potential fast track at the CJEU and the Lex NGO and the disappointing inaction for too long of a time on the Lex CU.
Yeah, so thanks. I mean, so courts can't do things by themselves. You know, what courts can do is to try to restrain governments while people take, you know, matters into their own hands to make sure that rights can be realized. You know, so courts are an assist. They assist rather than do the work. But here's where I think that, you know, since it's Human Rights Day, it's sort of worth thinking about a new conception of human rights. And I'm worried. So it's a good thing that people in Hungary have gotten used to going to Strasbourg. Although the Strasbourg, excuse me. Sorry, just coughing. Although the Strasbourg court is much less generous than it used to be. I think that actually, first of all, Hungarians should get used to trying to go to the European courts, the EU courts. They have a lot more power to do things, and I can work with people on how to do that. But here's the human rights issue. So the human rights that we have and the ones that are enforced in Strasbourg are the human rights that basically respond to the list of things that horrible governments did in the 20th century. And I think the biggest victory for human rights is that the repressive governments of the 21st century, well, take one like Hungary, are not engaged in obvious mass human rights violations of the old sort, right? So instead of putting journalists in jail, they just have their friends buy up the media. That is an advance in human rights, right? In some sense, but it still results in the same problem.
You don't need to do it the Turkey way.
Right, exactly. So, I mean, this is a victory for human rights that autocrats like Orban, who want to stay in the, you know, who want to be acceptable in good company elsewhere in Europe, don't do those things. But, you know, people in Hungary are still under pressure of the sort that human rights are supposed to solve. Orban puts people under economic pressure. He can cut off funding. He, you know, cuts down unemployment. He destroys the social safety net. He threatens people's jobs, right? He does all these things that put people under economic pressure. And frankly, because, you know, the the US and its allies won its side of the Cold War, the idea that a mandatory social safety net is part of the catalog of human rights kind of dropped out of the human rights repertoire. And so economic pressures on people aren't considered to be violations of rights. But I think that's a mistake, because everybody who's living with this now understands that there's a limit to what you can do and not do if you hope to keep your job in Hungary, if you hope to not have your business closed down, if you hope not to have your newspaper bought by some oligarch because you've gotten to be a little too freely critical of the government. So those economic pressures can have some of the same effects. And right now, certainly the rights recognized in Strasbourg are not those. Mostly the rights recognized at the EU are not those. But I think we need, in some sense, a new human rights movement to respond to the new ways in which governments are actually putting people under intolerable pressures.
Hmm. There's a very good question that is posed to you, Kim, but I would like to first turn to András, because I'd like to refer back to the roundtable discussions with the question. Our member of the audience is asking if Professor Scheppele thinks the new Hungarian constitution of 2012 is a legal, lawful constitution at all. Was it passed under legal conditions? Which comes to the question, András, what to do if the Orbán regime falls in 2022, which comes back to the question, if the roundtable talks may serve as any kind of a model for unavoidable negotiations between opposing views of the members of the opposition after a potential fall of the Orbán regime?
Well, making this constitution in voting for that in 2011, it was just a one-party constitution. Only Fidesz people voted for that. They discussed it in the parliament only for less than 10 days. So it is ridiculous, both procedurally and content-wise.
But what comes from this statement? What arises from this?
Well, but imagine that the Orbán regime is not developing to an autocracy, but it stops in 2012. I think that constitution could have worked, even if it was procedurally non-democratic. At that time, constitutional lawyers said that it is still a rule of law, it is still possible, there is still a constitutional court, there is an independent judiciary, etc. So I think only the fundamental law was not an obstacle for keeping democracy up. But in the light of the last 8 years since its implementation, it is now clear that the fundamental law should also be abolished, and there should be a new, broadly discussed constitution, which is not based on one political direction, one ideological preference, and so on. Now it is clear whether to go back to 89. I think maybe to the spirit of 89, but we should be much wiser now and more, paying attention to the possible negative consequences of any decision. And I think, there is much talk about this illiberal democracy, whether it is illiberal or not, or democracy or not. In my view, there is also a danger of liberal autocracy, that the basic rights are somehow guaranteed, the rights to private life, privacy. After all, the communist regime under Kádár gave some guarantees to private life. So Hungarians used to learn that it's okay if there is a right to privacy is in exchange for losing political rights. And because of the strong legal structure of the European Union, some basic rights are not violated. So It can happen, but democracy is abolished, I think. So in some ways, we can play these words, whether it is illiberal democracy or rather liberal autocracy. I think that it is closer to the second, that Orbán doesn't touch it eliminates the NGOs and political parties' chance to power, or at least he wants to do that, but he maintains the private rights of the citizens in order to maintain some sort of social peace. So therefore, it is not the Putin regime or the Erdogan regime in a sense that journalists are not killed, they are not imprisoned, protesters are not beaten up. I mean, there are more sophisticated measures to contain the protest. And it looks better on CNN that people are not bleeding on the streets. And they don't understand why it is a non-democratic regime, which is so clean and non-brutal. So I think we should think about also the alternative to illiberal democracy, the liberal autocracy. And I think this Orbán's constitution or Sire's constitution serves the purpose of a hybrid regime, a sort of new autocracy, which can maintain some liberal elements as a paying lip service, as a Potemkin regime, saying Orbán can sell himself as a democrat and hiding the reality of the regime.
Came from the question of what to do with the basic law that was lawfully accepted. I feel a parallel with the argument on the Supreme Court now in the US, so whether the court should be packed or that's just not something that could be done because that's the disrespect to the law or the rule of law or tradition, because it's, what can you do and what can you not do once something was legally passed?
Well, it depends what you mean by legally, of course. So I've made an argument basically that many of the reasons András just said, that the new constitution that was adopted in 2011 was adopted unconstitutionally. Mm-hmm. And it was adopted unconstitutionally because it was the work of one political party. In fact, one big difference between the roundtable constitution and the current thing that calls itself a constitution is that the roundtable constitution was very inclusive. Lots of parties were included. It went through, you know, just almost all of the factions that were present in 89, and then again in 90, because of course there were major amendments made after the first election as well, that they were more or less consensual, and that they were kind of ratified by public approval. The new constitution, everybody knows, was written by Fidesz for Fidesz, and it had no participation or buy-in or acceptance by anyone beyond Fidesz circles. And I think that makes it an illegitimate constitution. So when you're dealing with an illegitimate system, you don't have the same obligation to follow all of its rules to dismantle it. In fact, what I've often suggested is that we should think about going back to the rules of the prior constitution and picking up from there and treating the institutions and the entrenchments that have happened since then as presumptively illegitimate. So I think there are ways to distinguish, you know, court packing just because you're trying to reach a particular result from changing the composition of a court because the judges who were there were unconstitutionally appointed. In fact, some of the judges, it's really even simple, some of the judges didn't even meet the criteria in the law for being appointed as a judge. Those are the easy cases, but then there are others that are just, you know, one party appointments. So, you know, I think dismantling the system requires going back to what it was before because the constitution was illegitimately adopted.
Mm. Mr. Melia, let me ask you something that András brought up just for a sec. This Kádár tradition, this toxic content of our society with rights to privacy, as opposed to caring at all for political rights. Do you agree with the perception that Hungarian society or societies that are black backsliding are selfish, that we care more about individual rights than the health of our institutions, or of rights that we perceive as the rights of others? Those who do not agree with this cite the humongous demonstrations that we did have for media freedom or against the labor law amendment. Those who agree point out that, for example, there's a really big lack of interest to the changes to the constitution, or that the internet demonstration has been the largest ever. And that's not something that we commonly care about. That's something that we individually felt. What do you think of rights to privacy as opposed to caring for political rights in these countries, especially in Hungary now? That's the focus of our attention this time.
I think András is basically correct that it's harder to get people to care about abstractions, an abstract idea that's like a national civic value, than to care about something that affects them personally. As he talked about earlier, the economic distress of the 1990s had a major impact on confidence in democratic institutions and Western values. So people are affected mostly by their personal experience. That's right. And they care much more about something that's going to affect them personally. And I'm reminded, in listening to this discussion, I'm reminded of the early days of democracy sharing, if you will, which was really launched by the German party foundations long before the United States created the National Endowment for Democracy, political party institutes, and others. And the German party foundations would go abroad to places like Spain and Portugal when they were under military dictatorships and elsewhere, and share the ideas that inform their political parties, economic ideas, social justice ideas, their views on private property and things like that. And they developed relationships with like-minded people, whether they were in think tanks or proto-parties or other things. And I'm reminded that we more recently, and certainly the United States in our official aid programs and in much of what our NGOs do, we spend a lot more time talking about process and procedure, the letter of the law, than we do about the content, it's like the difference between liberalism and democracy. We focus, I think, to our detriment now, too much on democratic procedures and less on the democratic value of certain policies and certain actions. And I think we need to go back to that more fundamental approach to sharing information and ideas so that people will appreciate why the health of the wider society is important to their family's health, whether that's in a pandemic context or in a political constitutional context. That, it's like the old saying about the famous poem written in the 1940s, I think. They came for the communists and I didn't care because I was not a communist. They came for the socialists and I didn't care because I was not a socialist. But they came for the gays and the minorities and the Jews and I didn't care because I was none of that. And they came for me and there was no one left to care for me. And I think that's what autocrats depend on, that people won't care about the others. They won't care about the abstractions, they won't care about themselves. Until it's too late for anyone else to help them. And I think that's what we're seeing, as András pointed out in Hungary.
There has been a lot of questions still related to the courts, to Strasbourg, and also would like to come back for one sec because we have a CEU professor to the case of Lex CEU. András?
Yes, as we know, the Orbán government and the regime wants to eliminate autonomies, social, cultural, educational autonomies. They attacked the NGOs, and now the state universities are transformed into dubious foundational institutions under the control of the regime. And CEU was just one part of the story, but it had a big echo internationally, and thousands were protesting on the streets of Budapest when CEU was sort of driven out from Hungary due to this biased discriminative legislation of the regime. I am sorry to say, but unfortunately, this was done by the assistance of the previous or still current US administration. And the CEU is out, but there is still some remnants like the Democracy Institute, which is now established in the same building. And I am just wondering that I'm asking Thomas, first of all, whether he thinks that the new US administration under the presidency of Biden will change their mind and they will be ready to support these sort of autonomous initiatives like the Democracy Institute, which can be a place for like-minded people, NGOs, to come and organize themselves and to teach the new generations. I think it would be important and it would be a bit of minimal correction of the mistake of the previous government. Thank you.
Mr. Melia?
Well, yes, I think you'll see a distinctly different posture in the Biden administration compared to the Trump administration on a range of things, domestically and internationally. And Biden has talked about how he wants to reestablish the United States as a leading example of democracy. We have a lot of things to repair in our country. Some of them pre-existing Trump administration. I mean, we're still a work in progress ourselves, so we should be modest about how good an example we are providing to the world. But while we're working on strengthening our own democracy, I think the Biden administration will also be trying to reposition the United States as a leading advocate for democracy in other countries as well.
Which part of the world? I'm sorry, which part do you think would be the focus? Would the EU be proportionately a dominant and highlighted focus, or China or other parts are a lot more important?
Yeah, well, the Hungary is not the biggest item on the agenda in Washington. I think you have to realize that. Addressing much more direct threats to the United States that come from Russia and come from China economically, in cyberspace, and military positioning, those are going to take priority in terms of the challenges to be dealt with, as well as, you know, Iran and Saudi Arabia, Pakistan. But in those discussions, I think we're going to strengthen our relationships with the existing democracies and those who share our sense of a global international order that is working. So the EU is at the top of that list. You won't see the kind of insulting and denigrating language or behavior that you've seen from Donald Trump and his people in the last 4 years. You're going to see democratic allies valued and engaged much more vigorously by the Biden administration. And I know Tony Blinken pretty well, and I know some of the other people in Biden's inner circle, and they agree on this. They want the United States to not just return to where we were in the Obama days, because that wasn't perfect either, but to learn from what happened in the Obama administration, learn from what happened in the Trump administration. The world is in a different place than it was 4 years and 10 years ago. So you will see a much more engaged United States in partnership with democracies to address backsliding, provide assistance to civil society, including perhaps the kind of assistance that's going to be available at the Democracy Institute.
Kim, there were so many questions concerning the court that please, let's talk one more minute about that. Let me quote the question: what can a Hungarian citizen whose basic human rights are seriously and systematically abused? What do you think about this, about civil disobedience? This question refers to all of you. Why do some of the some people's cases last only a few months? And why do others have to wait in vain for answers or even case numbers from the Strasbourg court? And let's not forget that LexCU is not only to blame on the Trump government, but it could have been halted at the court. It was just dealt with plain too late.
Yeah, so courts are not fast, but let me just say one last thing about the US, just to add to what Tom was saying. We will, for the first time, have a president who had his honeymoon at Lake Balaton. In other words,
thanks to Tom Lantos.
Thanks to Tom Lantos, with whom Biden worked closely in the Senate. We have a nominee for Secretary of State whose mother was a Hungarian American and whose stepmother is a Hungarian Hungarian, and probably now an American as well. So in other words, at the very top levels of the US government, we have people who know Hungary well.
And we have a VP whose best friend from California is a previous Hungarian ambassador, Eleni Malakis.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. So what that means is that even though Hungary is probably not the strategic first priority of the US, it means that when items pertaining to Hungary come up, they're noticed and remembered in a way that would not be true with a country of Hungary's general size if it weren't for these personal connections. So I think this really is going to make a huge difference. Also, you know,
really?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I think that any country you have a strong, fond, and familial connection with is going to be a country that registers on your mental map more than a country that you only know about from briefings, you know? So I do think that makes a difference. And I think also that one of the aspects of Trump policy that's going to be rejected is Trump's love of every dictator he ever met, you know? So I think there really is going to be a rejection of autocratic leaders and a reinforcement of, and, you know, much more public admiration for and embrace of democratic governments.
So, let me be provocative, Kim, if you allow me. Let me quote Mr. Melia from an interview that he had with one of the Hungarian outlets on President Trump's and the visit of Prime Minister Orban. And I think Thomas said, President Trump likes people who he can sell things to. And that's a cynical thing, but the US likes to sell things to other countries.
Yeah, right, and Hungary's buying all these weapons and everything else. I mean, there's a, you know, I mean, so I think Hungary and the US will have, how to put it, we should be on the same sides of most issues. And insofar as we're not, it's no longer mostly the US that's causing that problem, I think. But also, you know, what you saw, I mean, Biden's first statement was embracing allies, right? Embracing NATO, embracing the EU as the EU and not trying to pick it apart. So I mean, I do think it will make a huge difference. And frankly, here's something else. I mean, the US, how to put it? It would be wonderful if the US sent a career diplomat as an ambassador to Hungary. And
for
I me. Actually,
back
well,
to the
I mean, we have André here on the call. I mean, you know, we've been able to get career people in charge of the embassy in between ambassadors, you know, but I'm hoping, and I think that a new Biden administration, and certainly Tony Blinken, who's a longtime friend of the State Department, I think is gonna be trying to put more career ambassadors in. And so, you know, I'm hoping that Hungary will benefit from that. I have no say over any of this. But I wondered if it's possible to switch to the question about the court. So here's one of the problems with Strasbourg. So I know that everybody thinks of Strasbourg as the court where you go to realize human rights. And it's a problem right now. Okay, it's a problem right now because the Strasbourg court made a decision, I guess it was a year ago, October, that, in order to, quote, exhaust domestic remedies, that's the legal language, you have to try every opportunity in your home country before you can go to Strasbourg. And, you know, a year and a half ago or so, a little over a year ago, the Strasbourg court decided that in Hungary now, that includes going to the constitutional court before you can go to Strasbourg. So no more just going, you know, from the that used to be the Legfelsenbierzeg, now it's the Curia, you know, no longer just going from there to Strasbourg, you have to go to the Constitutional Court. And that's terrible because the Constitutional Court has no deadline by which it has to decide cases. So the case can go there and it can die. And there's no way you can push the case out of the Constitutional Court. So the Orban regime, which has, shall we say, a disproportionate influence on the judges of the Constitutional Court, can bottle up cases there, can stop the cases from getting to Strasbourg. So I'm very worried about this. I think it was a terrible decision of the Strasbourg court. That's one thing. The second thing is that the Strasbourg court has been attacked by the UK, by Russia, by Turkey. I mean, a number of countries have been refusing to enforce judgments or really been attacking the judges. There was a referendum in Switzerland, about getting out of the Council of Europe and quitting the Court of Human Rights. They were terrified about that at the court. So the court is now pulling back. It's like a turtle that's pulling its head back into its shell. And you see them making decisions that are not as brave as they used to make, you know, and while they're under all this political pressure. So it's not a great time to rely heavily on Strasbourg from Hungary, first, because you can't get there. And second, when you get there, you may not get the remedy that you hope for. So the EU courts, on the other hand, the European Court of Justice, very hard to get cases there. We should talk about how to do it. But that court is now expanding its conception of rights. And moreover, if there's a judgment from Strasbourg, from Luxembourg that is not complied with, then there can be really serious sanctions against the state that is refusing to comply from Brussels. Now, Lex CEU. Okay, so is Hungary complying with the Lex CEU decision? No. Where's the European Commission that should say, okay, you should welcome CEU back? They're missing in action. Okay, this is another problem. The von der Leyen Commission has been trying to avoid all rule of law questions. And you see it in this latest appeasement agreement I put in the chat, that now this has been adopted, this agreement that we just saw 24 hours ago, and it's terrible. Angela Merkel and von der Leyen worked together, and they have given Orban a free pass for 2 years, basically. And this is what we're dealing with now at the European Commission. So, you know, it's not a great time to be relying on your external friends in Europe. So the US is getting better as a friend who will stand up for human rights and civil society and democracy in Hungary. And the European institutions are getting worse. So what you would love is if they all got better at the same time, but I'm afraid that's where we are right now.
On that note, I'd like to ask all three of you to kind of help sum up with the audience feeling empowered and optimistic about, I would like to hear your opinion on what? What should we hang on to besides the US hopefully getting better and the EU institutions getting worse? Mr. Melia?
Well, at these moments, I like to quote my favorite American philosopher, Yogi Berra, who said, it's really hard to make predictions, especially about the future. So I'm not sure I can tell you what's going to come, but I do know that the United States is going to be more forward-leaning on these matters generally, and I think specifically with regard to Hungary and its neighbors. And you know, as I said earlier, the international community and your friends around the world can't want human rights and democracy in Hungary more than the people of Hungary want it. And I know about the propaganda, I know about the capture of the media and other institutions that are limiting people's access to democratic discourse. But that ultimately is going to have to be. It's happened before in Hungary. Hungary had a democratic sensibility throughout the most repressive years of Soviet domination. That's why they rose up in 1956. That's why they were ready to be moving into the negotiations back in 1989 and 1990. So I know that that democratic sensibility is out there in the Hungarian population. But as I mentioned earlier, I think more can be done to strengthen that democratic sensibility, you know, throughout the population in the next generation, across the country, well beyond Budapest. There may be ways that Hungarians can benefit from other countries' experience, providing that kind of civic education to more and more people across the country of Hungary.
Thank you so much. András?
I think I am an extremely optimistic person after spending the last 10 years in Hungary and being kicked out from the country with my university. I think the mood is changing. there was an overwhelming material advantage on the side of the government last year. And still in Budapest and several countryside towns and cities, the opposition managed to win. Maybe it was because the government did not take it very seriously and they did not expect that they can lose. But the illusion that they are monopolistic and control everything, it is an illusion. They cannot control everything. And the mood is changing. And I think it might influence the voters of Fidesz as well. It was always considered that the Fidesz voters are extremely committed to support Viktor Orbán and his party. Now the question is to what extent they can be fed by these extra sources coming from the European Union. But I think now we can safely say that the majority of the country would be voting against Fidesz. And Budapest will never go back to Fidesz. And the question is whether they will change still the electoral law in a way to make it even more disproportionate to make sure to win the 2022 elections. But you know, cheating has also a price. So it can lead to violent clashes on the main square after the cheated elections, as we learned from Kiev, from the Orange Revolution. So I think it is also risky if you take a look on the story of Ukraine and Belarus. I am not sure that they will take this risk. I think Orbán will try to figure out a softer solution and hope it will be, he will be mistaken on that.
Thank you, András. Professor Scheppele.
Yeah, so one of the reasons why I always have felt so at home in Hungary is that everybody read Mizimotsko and identified with Fidesz, as I did as a kid. So I'm a little bit inclined toward depressing conclusions and depressing characters. But I think actually that, you know, I want to agree with what Tom said, that, and I hear this whenever I try to get help for Hungary from outside, that nobody can want democracy more than Hungarians want democracy. The EU can't make democracy in Hungary. The US can't make democracy in Hungary. The EU and the US can support democratic forces in Hungary, but there have to be democratic forces in Hungary to support. So I look now at what's happening, of course, in Hungary, and I also look at what's happening in Poland. And I do think that the Hungarian democratic opposition can learn a lot from what's happening in Poland. So first, civil society is massively organized. Every time there's a violation, no matter what the weather, even with the pandemic, people are out on the streets. They have web pages where they translate all of their statements, you know, into English or into some bigger language, and Polish is a bigger language than Hungarian, so that journalists understand what's going on, right? And to just publicize every detail of what's happening so that the outside world can see it. And one of the things that that does is it brings the opposition in Poland together with itself, right? Because there's a set of projects that it's involved in. And as a result, there you have the feeling that the opposition is just a wall that the government can't breach. And, you know, in Hungary, I always think it's a nation of chess players. You know, everybody can see that 10 steps down, 10 moves away, there's a checkmate. So why bother playing the whole game? So everybody goes home. But you actually, for an international audience and also for each other, have to be there through every step, because even though in chess the outcome may be foreordained, that's not true in politics. And so just actually standing up for democracy, even when it looks hopeless, will bring you friends and allies and support, and may help you also support each other in that cause. And those of us from outside will do all we can, but we can't do it without everybody from the inside.
Thank you so much. I'd like to thank members of this panel, of this roundtable discussion. It was an honor to be with you today. And it was thrilling to see how many members of the audience stayed with us for this whole long time. Thank you for this. I'd like to ask you to take good care of yourself and to take, for all of us, better care of our rights and democracy. Thank you very much for your attention and being here with us today.
Köszönöm szépen.
Köszönjük szépen.